There are occasions where I just don't want to accept that many kids these days don't bother with the old, obscure, or otherwise hidden gems that the anime medium is actually chock full of. As the years continue to pass, there are many series that have fallen into a sort of limbo where they don't really enjoy much new attention, or sometimes they just never got much attention to begin with despite being a jolly good time. And so, I decided to make this video about one such. If you even glanced at the title, you would know that I am talking about an anime by the name of Gankutsuou. Now, it is acknowledged as a classic by the old guard of the anime community, and typically most people who have seen it, but like I was alluding to just now, you barely hear anyone talk about it today. I may not be the first to bathe this anime in a new light, but damn it if I'm not going to try and make some sort of difference nonetheless, however small that difference might be. With only a ludicrous sub 200,000 members on MAL, it deserves a lot more eyeballs greedily absorbing its colorful and just downright amazing contents than it has in recent years. Or any years, really. It just deserves better in general. And this video is not meant for hyperweebs, so just chill if you already know about this anime, okay? Just do a little chilly chill chill. This is for the unfortunate majority who haven't seen or heard of it. And if you are one of those people, then today I want to tell you about a story. A truly unforgettable story about vengeance, friendship, humanity, isolation, and fatalism. One which, as an adaptation itself, pays its dues to the original and easily justifies its own existence. This one's gonna have a bit more structure to it than usual because I felt like it, so yeah. It's kind of a review, but I also really want to talk about the themes because they mean a lot to me. So anyway, let's get cracking on why you should watch Gankutsuou, The Count of Monte Cristo. But first, just really quick, I need to put it out there that the actual book by Alexandre Dumas is a perfect masterpiece and literally everyone should read it before they die. But we're mainly here to discuss the anime, so here we go. Revenge is a concept, an idea, one which I have personally thought about a lot over the course of my life. Is it justified? If so, when, under what circumstances? If it is, to what extent should it be delivered? Should it match the wrongdoing precisely, or is it justified, perhaps even ideal, for revenge to exceed the wrongdoing? The answers to these questions are varied. They're opinions. But there is an anime that does an impressive job of answering them nonetheless, and in my opinion, impressive is truly an understatement. Gankutsuou, or The Count of Monte Cristo, takes it all on with vigor and confidence. From the first few shots, Gankutsuou absolutely mesmerized me with its unique visual style. Based on the legendary book of the same name, well, that name, this anime unquestionably does justice to the original story. And original is an important thing to define here. Gankutsuou doesn't follow the exact established story. The setting is wildly different, being, what, 3,000 years in the future and also in space, and it's also told from a different perspective. At first. Eventually, this perspective ends up changing hands, or rather, eyes, a few different times. Gonzo is the name of the studio who so artfully crafted this masterpiece, which is quite surprising to me because I generally tend not to like their work. The directing was undertaken by Mahiro Maeda, who, even by 2004 standards, was already an industry veteran at the time. Having worked on Evangelion, Gunbuster, and several Ghibli classics, this anime definitely landed in worthy hands with Maeda. Maeda makes the story work as well as it does because he doesn't betray the spirit of the source, even in spite of the significant distinction that this anime must employ in order to give it a life of its own. Minor spoiler. Vengeance is justified, both being that which the story seeks to profess and in my own earned opinion. Like I said, I've had reason to ponder this more than even Seneca or Marcus Aurelius likely ever did. And it is in this flip side from how media usually treats the subject of revenge where Gankutsuou derives much of its value for me personally. I mean, it's easy for any piece of media to do this, but competency matters, and it is definitely not something to worry about in this particular instance. Hitherto, in my long-spanning media-consuming history, the idea of revenge is usually given the largely undue treatment of being absolutely marinated in no-no sauce. It is most often shown that revenge, even if justified, comes at too large a cost. That even if it is deserved or right, it isn't worth what comes with it. Gankutsuou isn't the first thing I've seen that tosses that highly romanticized notion aside in favor of more realistic themes, but it is the first I've seen do so intelligently. It convinces in a way that is not only personally identifiable to me, but in a way that is so well articulated that it almost seems to free itself from the confines of opinion. That is how powerful this story truly is. But in the end, it still is opinion, no matter how eminent. And speaking of opinions, it's time to lay those out in neat little sections like if I had a table at the local swap meet. Let's begin with the story. Our story begins when the Viscount Albert de Morcerf, while enjoying the events of the annual Luna Carnival bearing semblance to the real-world Roman Carnival, meets a mysterious gentleman who calls himself the Count of Monte Cristo. I will tell you right now that these are the two key figures the story revolves around, and who take turns controlling the perspective I mentioned earlier. The story begins through the eyes of Albert. Anyway, the Count procures for him a life-saving favor by rescuing him from the hands of Luna's banditti, and in return wants only for Albert to act as his intermediary into the upper echelons of the Parisian aristocracy. Counts, barons, dukes, and duchesses. You know, like from Pokemon X and Y. By the way, Generation 6 is the best generation. Yeah, I'm just putting it out there because I'm fucking right. Well, this introduction takes place, and not long after that, we begin to notice that it, as well as many other events we have seen or that still lurk in the darkness, are all the result of premeditation by this calculating entity. The various nobles to which he has made acquaintance, not for the first time, slowly become caught in an intricate web of deceit that cares not who is entrapped as long as its ends are realized. But how could this chance encounter between Albert and the Count lead to this grand enactment of revenge? That too is all according to Keikaku. And once this downpour of past resentment and hatred begins, it appears impossible for anyone to end it. It's important to note that while the anime adaptation does start out here, the book actually has a lot more exposition. Think like 23.474178403755868% more exposition. About an entire fourth of the book. But these events are paid homage to and remembered in a number of different flashback scenes and even some stuff unique to the anime just to provide the viewer with some juicy context. Glass half full perspective? It's the foundation of the mystery. The story is one that spends its time telling a tale of a man, deceiving everyone through gaining esteem and social standing, when it suddenly unloads its themes and the extremely overpowering and authoritative conclusions it draws for them. The novel puts the reader in a position of understanding almost from the get-go and takes a meandering path through the spirit of a good-natured human being before arriving at the same conclusions, albeit a bit more gently. I'm going to try keeping the book comparisons infrequent, but we'll just have to see, because I fucking love that book and I do not hesitate to call it my favorite of all time. Back to the anime, it doesn't exactly have a well-established goal for a little bit. And while that may seem like a weakness in a story that is known mostly for its themes, it does a surprisingly good job of circumventing that constraint. Taking place in the world of European nobility, well, the future space version of it anyway, it's pretty cool to observe a world once entirely real but now far removed from our own world and society that we know today. Characters interact using only the most formal demeanors and educated lexical speech of the time, which makes for more than just a window into this world, it makes you feel like you're part of it. The dialed-in presentation makes sure of that. The horse-drawn carriages and servants for every individual task and the general air that the society of the time exists in all do a good job of helping that idea along even more. Why do they even have a need for horses in such a high-tech world, though? Maybe they just think it makes them look cooler or something. I don't even know if they're real horses. Sometimes they seem like robots or at least mechanically enhanced horses. I don't even know why I'm talking about the stupid horses. Moving on. It may be millennia into the future from the 1800s setting the novel uses, but it does a good job of emulating that setting in spite of the spaceships and proto-Madoka Magica Paris. It just works, trust me. The blend of that weird circus stuff in the European architecture of the 1800s just looks good. It also supports the mysterious atmosphere which permeates the show, which is another strength brought to the table here. There is always something about the tone that is hard to put your finger on. The first half manages to be a fun experience just through aspects like these as well as its characters. Especially the Count. If anything could ever be called enigmatic, it's the Count himself. But we'll get more into these amazing characters in a bit. And when the second half begins moving each piece into place, everything in the previous series of events, mundane or otherwise, is suddenly laid bare to express purpose and careful planning. The manner in which everything comes together toward the end of this story is to this day the most satisfying I have ever had the pleasure of beholding. This expertly demonstrated drama is the glue which holds it all together. As there isn't really much action or comedy or whatever else most shows revolve around, Gankutsuou's focal point is the drama, and of course, the pawns and kings of that drama, the characters. All of them, without exception, play an important role, even if some characters don't seem very important early on. The story couldn't work in the same way if even one were removed. They are all crucial to each other, for better or worse. Each and every character has a different temperament and personality that are all fleshed out incredibly well. And I mean well in a realistic sense. Anime contains a lot of characters that are done well, but seldom realistically. Not being realistic doesn't take away from anything most of the time. Fiction is fiction for a reason. But it's nice to see attention and solicitude paid to making these characters feel real. It's a nice change of pace in this medium. I think this is mainly due to the attention to detail used in mirroring the work of Alexandre Dumas. But the excellent scripting by Natsuko Takahashi should be noted as well. The dialogue is always pleasant and uses interesting metaphors that, again, are evocative of the lexicon possessed only by the educated class of the time, which most of our characters are. Remarkable diligence is paid in the accuracy of these characters in relation to their novel counterparts. In fact, it goes way beyond just the characters. Even small conversations regularly play out much in the same way. Gankutsuou does contain its fair share of deviations here and there, but they're well done and don't compromise too many facets of any individual character. And there are plenty of cool Easter eggs for those familiar with the novel. Some minor characters are different, but not in a bad way. Some roles are appropriately more or less important than they are in the novel, which I understand is necessary to differentiate this version, but it can be charming. One small but amazing detail that I noticed is included is that of the Count's signature smile. It is described in the book all the time throughout his interactions with others as a reactive smile peculiar to him. It's really a negligible thing that easily could have been left out, but the fact that it wasn't just goes to show the commitment to thoroughness the staff took upon themselves. They genuinely cared about this adaptation. And since I'm talking about the Count and basically rambling at this point, now's a great time to move on to his character and some more characters too. First, the obvious one. The Count of Monte Cristo is charming, manipulative, seductive, learned and intelligent, and he seems to those around him to have the capabilities of a god. He is portrayed to the audience much in the same way as to the other characters as the singular, grandiose being that is similarly portrayed in the novel, and it does this very well and in an extremely convincing fashion. I felt like I was one of the onlookers the first time the Count appeared on the screen. Maida's directing is extremely competent in getting the viewer to feel like part of the world, I cannot stress that enough, and it is only in the quiet moments with his servants that any shred of a human being can be thought to hide underneath, and a more intimate understanding of his goals and intentions might be discerned. This is a man who has been hurt beyond imagination and had no support system to get through it. Misery was unanimous with existence for so long that in the new life he's gained, his one goal should be empathetically understood. Death is not enough to appease his sense of justice. No less would do the job than eternal suffering for his enemies. The man says it himself, he is not fucking around. From subtly fucking with them, to really fucking with them, to downright driving them to the worst end they can conceive of themselves personally, I'll say it again. He is not fucking around. All from the shadows at first, but with a boldness you wouldn't expect and without even a hint of cowardice or shame. Joji Nakata is the best possible casting choice to play the Count. There's hardly an actor who is better suited to play such an unspeakably charismatic and imposing person. Known for many roles, but perhaps most prominently as Type Moon's go-to cunning bad guy, it's easy to see how they nailed the casting choice with this one. He just has that certain ominous quality. The Count is easily my favorite character, and while he may make the greatest overall impression, the other characters are great too. Next we have Albert Morcerf, the son of the Count and Countess de Morcerf. We know that Albert is the reason that this story is able to begin, and we also know that an invisible hand guided that beginning. But no matter how much I agree and sympathize with the Count, it is still sad to watch Albert, who is filled with so much innocence and admiration for the Count, be used as a puppet. The fact that this is done out of necessity but not without genuine friendship is a gloomy but beautiful thing to behold. He's brazen, honorable, and carries an excessive pride for the status of himself and his family in society. But he's not the snobby rich guy you might have the impression of. He cares for his friends as much as he does himself and would not hesitate to risk his life for them. Watching his development is sad, but at the same time, it's gratifying. To see a young adolescent slowly lose all sense of innocence, but to meet the darkness of the world with such a strong will definitely instilled a sense of respect and admiration in me. Jun Fukuyama easily presents the tumultuous characteristics a teenager like Albert should have, and his honorable nature is driven home too. Overall, he delivers an especially emotional performance from beginning to end that left me feeling more sorry for Albert than I think I was really supposed to. Together with the Count, they resemble a parallel I've seen before, but which reaches toward an entirely different conclusion. These two are the heart of the show, and while not any sort of dynamic duo, their relationship is wonderful to watch. Albert's friends all get along like a little doggy and generally come off as a wholesome group you would expect to see in some kind of anime with a high school setting. There's Franz, his best friend, who's pretty important. He acts as the voice of reason for Albert when that overzealous personality takes over sometimes. Beauchamp, the journalist, is there to make sarcastic remarks. Chateau Renaud is totally a good boy. Eugenie, Albert's fiancé, is a darling person and pianist with some touching development of her own, and Maximilian and Valentine constitute a traditional romance. They're a group with all their own dramas and stories to tell, but which all return to the bigger picture at hand that the Count is secretly orchestrating. Haydée, the Count's adopted daughter, is described in the novel as being the most beautiful creature that the human imagination could possibly come up with, mostly in the physical sense, but also in her principles. And I find this adaptation to be satisfactorily persuasive in its depiction of her. Her past traumas and the person she is as a result of them is beautifully shown to us. His other servants and pseudo-servants never effectively take the stage, so to speak, but they all add something and are fun in their own unique ways. The voice cast in general does an amazing job, leaving me with zero qualms as to the quality of the acting. The work is impressive and dedicated, and you can definitely look forward to it. All of the characters are important and crucial to the story, but I don't want to talk about them too much. The villains especially. And by villains, I refer to the people whose happiness and livelihoods the Count means to quell. Their identities will be kept a secret within the confines of this video. It's not that big of a deal really, but I went over the main characters and that's what matters most. I want some of these characters to remain a surprise. So let's move on to the technical aspects. Technical quality doesn't matter much to a lot of people, animation especially, and I'm actually a part of that group myself, but I was happy to find I wanted to talk about it for this anime. The first thing I want to get into is the art. And the first thing I'll say about it, and it's impossible not to notice this, is that the character's clothing will have weird designs that move off the article in question into nothing, like when you drag a window too far off a monitor. But like, in reverse, I just don't know how else to describe it. It's a very strange use of compositing, and it only applies to the clothing and also hair for some reason, but it's a very unique idea that I'm glad to see put to use here. The whole thing walks a line between art house and avant-garde. There are plenty of sceneries and backgrounds that are just out of this world, both in the figurative sense and, well, whatever the fuck this thing is. And I mean multiple times an episode kind of plenty. The color palettes used throughout all the show are bountiful and just cool looking. The animation in general is nothing amazing, but it's in no way bad either. The indulgent, high-effort art and the shots which present it more than makes up for any lack of enthusiasm with the animation. The show is visually amazing regardless of animation, and that seems to be one of its chief aims. The CGI actually doesn't offend the eye too much thanks to the rest of the art style's facets like the unusual backgrounds and just the general strangeness pervading the whole thing. I'm not trying to say it's good CGI, it's definitely bad, but it isn't jarring thanks to the rest of the visual makeup, and that's what really counts. Plus, it isn't used often, so the show is largely able to get away with it. Overall, every little quirk in the visual direction comes together to create an extremely memorable package, and many of the shots, along with the music that accompanies them, are the epitome of grandiose and wrap the drama that they portray into one seriously entrancing package. Speaking of the music, it's wonderful, making appropriate and well-timed use of the real classical operas of Tchaikovsky, who probably needs no introduction, and other classical composers of the era in addition to its own original music. The classical is primarily what you hear, but it's usually very quiet. Sort of like a step up from elevator music, which is precisely the right fit for a lot of the anime scenes. The lofty, bombastic presence which classical usually carries with it is only there when it's suitable, such as with the attending of literal operas or other performances, and when the drama reaches its highest peaks. There are a couple tracks that give me chills and are capable of speaking more than the actual dialogue that accompanies them. No slight to the script, the music is just that good sometimes. The blend of Spanish guitar working the Phrygian mode of the natural minor scale and the dissonant ambience, which is sometimes used to recall the past or to imply great foreboding, is a spellbinding combination. This anime uses its music with greater care than most others, paying careful attention not to reuse tracks too often. It's very often haunting, uneasy, but never seems to overstay its welcome. Melancholy in remembrance of lives lost, mystical when stricken with awe, tense when pride is at stake, and triumphant when righteous ambitions are met. The OP is a relaxing song which forgoes the more energetic poppy sound we're used to in anime for one sung in English with a more serene feel to it. The visuals here are even more avant-garde than the anime proper, no thanks to the extremely rustic style, but still manages to be of interest because of all the symbolism used. The ending theme is a stark but good departure from the elegant music that usually accompanies the series. It has a really wild and psychedelic energy that doesn't really suit the show in any way, but at least is a good song in its own right. It's the kind of thing you would see Beavis and Butthead jam out to after they get their hands on the gnarliest drugs they can possibly find. On occasions, the sudden absence of sound successfully instills fear or awe. In general, the sound design is natural feeling, the type that impresses while not really trying to impress. The attention to detail and realism is there. Overall, I think paying attention to some of the technical efforts are well worth it and definitely enrich the experience if you are taking it slow and steady. And now, we come to the verdict. The verdict for an anime so close to my heart that my opinion of it is admittedly a bit colored. There isn't really anything I dislike about it. What we have in the end is an anime that makes a profound statement, but even more than that, it cares about telling an amazing story. But the philosophies employed and the methods that this story uses to communicate them are the crown jewels of this experience. So I want to take a bit of a deeper look into that as we find a note to end on. There are more envoys of these themes at work in the show, but there is a series of quotes in the book that I think best describe the Count's view. As he is the story's principal character, this is clearly important to the main theme. The conversation, again from the book, but still accurate to the variations of the characters in the anime, takes place between the Count of Monte Cristo and Albert's dearest friend, Franz. This exchange relates the naive, often patronizing and supercilious thinking that society at large looks upon the idea of revenge with, held here by young Franz, to the more developed and discerning reasoning held by the Count, which he offers to Franz in the spirit of good conversation. Now for some brief excerpts. If a man had by unheard of and excruciating tortures destroyed your father, your mother, your mistress, in a word, one of those beings who, when they are torn from you, leave a desolation, a wound that never closes, in your breast, do you think the reparation that society gives you sufficient by causing the knife of the guillotine to pass between the base of the occiput and the trapezial muscles of the murderer, because he who has caused us years of moral sufferings undergoes a few moments of physical pain? This quote from the Count indeed gnostically asserts that revenge is self-justified, that the avenger is and should be their own judge, jury, and executioner. What good is punishment by some arbitrary set of laws if it does not appease the victim? Another part that shortly follows this last one is also very constructive and profound. Hatred is blind, rage carries you away, and he who pours out vengeance runs the risk of tasting a bitter draught. That isn't the constructive and profound part. To which the Count responds, "Yes, if he be poor and inexperienced, not if he be rich and skillful. Besides, the worst that could happen to him would be the punishment of which we have already spoken, and which the philanthropic French Revolution has substituted for being torn to pieces by horses or broken on the wheel. What matters this punishment as long as he is avenged?" I love this exchange because the Count takes Franz's wet behind the ears way of thinking and tells him that the attitude he holds need only apply to the poor and inexperienced. In other words, for those without the means and wisdom to enact a suitable revenge. To those unenlightened and susceptible to all manner of guilt, failure, and regret. To those who cannot prevent hatred from tainting their happiness. And then later doubling down on the idea that revenge is self-satisfied, what matters this punishment as long as he is avenged? This particular conversation is really gratifying for me because of the way that the Count converses with Franz respectfully on the subject, yet betrays an air of superiority for his own earned opinion. Rather than entertain a debate, he sees this interaction in the context of a teacher-student relationship where he is the teacher and Franz is the student. The anime definitely mirrors this sentiment with a great example of show-don't-tell, which silently creeps up and establishes itself powerfully in the end. I really wish Maida were directing more anime these days. It shows us that no matter how much one disagrees with an Avenger, they have no place to impose any authority over them or try to stop them. I feel that the ideas and philosophies surrounding revenge are something all people should explore and ponder more than society encourages it, because in fact it discourages it. And I think that Gankutsuou is perhaps the best example in media that fights that good fight. It questions and directly challenges the societal norm, which is something that most people aren't brave enough to do. It stands tall to announce that vengeance is not wrong, and that those who commit heinous wrongdoings deserve to meet the worst kinds of fates. And I proudly stand beside that. In the end, it's not something that any one morality is able to dictate and is truly up to each individual's interpretation and conclusion, regardless of how shallow or advanced their worldview may be. Here's to hoping that more people end up witnessing the spectacle of a drama, that more people are left reeling from that feeling of grandeur after finishing the final episode, and I hope I helped you want to do that. At times brutal, sinister, and terrifying, while joyous, heartfelt, and poetic at others, Gankutsuou is a title worthy of being called masterpiece and deserves to be watched by everyone. Hey, hopefully you enjoyed this video. If you in fact did enjoy it and want to see more anime content, be sure to hit like, sub, hit the bell, and let me know what you do want to see. The channel has passed the 500 subscriber mark. Thanks to everyone for being a part of this. If you're new to the channel, check out some of my other videos like the ones about Dr. Stone and My Hero Academia. If you like Twitch streams, I'm a partner over there. You can find me streaming anime games like Fate Grand Order, so follow me there to catch the streams. Follow my Twitter and join the Discord server too if you're so inclined. Links for all these in the description. Thanks for watching the video, sayonara, and I'll see you again.